My crystal ball tells me that we're going to a very interesting segment next. We're going to the Tampa Bay Convention Center to see the Discovery Exposition. Let's take a look at that now.
Discovery 92 Expo at Tampa Convention Center. What are you doing here? What is your name, sir?
I'm Brian Stone.
Okay.
I'm a clinical hypnotherapist, and I'm a distributor of the Voyager. The Voyager is a light and sound device. The research that backs this up comes out of the biofeedback movement of the last 30 years. Mm-hmm. And basically what light and sound does is generate a frequency that the brain is very willing to follow. And as the program changes, it takes you into very natural altered states. Same states that you would go into when you're sleeping. Also if you meditate or if you were into hypnosis, same states. So this just does it, giving you a light show, which gives you something to focus on, and the effects are phenomenal.
So these are the little wonder glasses.
These are the glasses. This is actually the computer that does it all. It's all done through the modern miracles of microelectronics, so it's actually a computer and it's all done on chips.
With fiber optics and stuff.
microchips, and a lot of people ask, are there subliminals in it? No, there's no talking. It's just sound and light.
Oh, and there's the lights right there.
Everyday usage, people find that they sleep better, maybe not as long, but they're able to get more out of their sleep, be more productive. They've done a lot of studies with IQ and intelligence and find that children using these, their IQs go up, their ability to memorize facts goes up. So it's a lot of things from both the mental, emotional, to the spiritual. It seems to kind of deal with it all.
Well, that's great. So have you had a lot of people taking advantage of your little booth here?
It's been phenomenal.
That's great.
Been phenomenal.
Hi Zach, how you doing?
Good. Yourself?
Very well, thank you. This is a fascinating t-shirt you got on. Free Tibet from the Chinese, of course.
Of course.
What have you got here?
This is called a purba. It's a Kali purba. It's used to exorcise demons out of either human bodies or in tantric rituals.
And how is it applied?
Well, it's usually done in conjunction with the damaru, which is this right here.
Uh-huh.
A Tibetan lama or a priest or a Tibetan shaman would hold this in his right hand, and by doing this,
what about the human relics? We've been hearing a lot about
you
that.
Can get tantric, like Kapala feasting bowls.
Feasting bowl.
Right, it's a bowl that's used in conjunction with the purba to feed demons. The whole thing about Tibetan Buddhism is you want to call the demon forward so you can slay it.
Yeah.
Whereas in Christianity, for instance, demons are suppressed.
Right.
So they never really get a chance to be slain. But the Kapala is a skull cap. Typically, the ones that are most effective come from the Tibetan's lama's skull. They're cut in half, and then they're done with silver, and then they're laden with offerings.
Now, does a lama have any choice in whether he donates his skull to be used as a chalice?
Well, that's a good question, but the thing is that after the body has ceased, we don't particularly have any use for it. I mean, the only thing we're concerned with is life, and the body just represents a structure.
Yeah, I see.
They typically will make feasting bowls out of human skulls, as well as the skull itself. It's called a Kapala, and then they also make flutes out of a thigh bone.
Ah, lovely. Edwards with Videotropic. I'm here at the Discovery Expo, and with me is Elaine Ulrich.
That's right.
I got it right. Well, it's nice to be talking to you, Elaine. Now, your drawings are classified as automatic because you actually are not the person who draws them. Isn't that true?
That's true.
And who, in fact, does do these drawings?
Most of them are done by Leonardo da Vinci.
I see.
I do have other artists that step in, but he's the main one that comes through.
And how does this actually happen? He invades your arm up to a certain point.
Yes, usually up to the elbow.
Up to the elbow. And then your arm just takes over and just, like magic, draws the pictures themselves. Oh, that's incredible.
Yep, I see his hand over the top of mine. It's old and gnarled, big knuckles, age spots, little hair on the part, white hair, by the way, curly hair. And then there's this white cuff with a big blousy sleeve. And sometimes I can feel his beard tickling against my skin.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes I can smell his breath, like he's got wine on his breath.
Really?
Yeah, he loves wine.
Now, how long have you been experiencing this kind of sensation? Quite a while, I understand.
Well, I've been doing the portraits for about 15 years. I started out before that doing automatic writing, and then it switched to the drawing, so...
And you were telling me that you've been hearing voices since you were three.
I've been seeing angels and hearing them since I was three.
What kind of things do they tell you?
Whatever I want to know.
Hi, now we're here with... What is your name?
Philomena Tamaro, and I live in Port Richey, Florida.
And you've seen apparitions of the Virgin Mary, is that correct?
Yes, I have.
Okay, would you tell us about it?
Of course I will. I saw the apparition of the Blessed Mother on April 13th of 1992. Photographs here that I'm going to show you are the actual photographs that I have taken with my camera. This is where the apparition sites are actually appearing. In this home over here at the right, where my finger is, this is where the apparition house is.
And she sees this regularly, or did she only see it once?
She sees this the 13th of every month at 12 o'clock.
Gee.
The same way that...
I didn't know the Virgin was so punctual.
Oh, yes. This is when she descended into the apparition home, and this was the shot that I got just before she descended in. You could see
now,
it
Now, where
actually,
is the Virgin Mary in that? I really have trouble seeing that.
Right here.
Uh-huh. And that's at the 13th of every month at 12 o'clock, folks. You can see the Virgin Mary in Conyers, Georgia.
In case that wasn't quite clear, what we have here is a photograph of the sun. Now, this ray coming out of the sun is what the Virgin Mary uses to descend. And this smudge here is a vague outline of a cowled figure. And apparently, witnesses claim that she emerges out of the sun, travels down this sunbeam, and goes into what they call the apparition house, where she appears inside the house. Now, here is another photograph taken at Conyers, Georgia, and this has a peculiar outline of a door, which is also kind of inexplicable, or maybe not. Maybe this is some sort of pattern caused by sunlight bouncing around inside the camera. We don't know. Also of interest, in the shadows and the clouds above the sun in this photograph is the face of a demon, and we did a little drawing here to make it more clear.